monitoring, right? Let's take benefit of monitoring. That's a completed instance. And anytime I can right click and view track events. And as you can see here, here are my track events. And finally here, this is my assigned catalog. Okay, and finally I have a warning called catalog expired. I'm emitting that from inside the app fabric. Okay? So because 1 minute passed by, I have expired my catalog. Okay, is that clear? Very good. Let's clear the database again. And let's now force the other part of the pick branch. So now I will not wait 1 minute. I will submit an order to reserve my catalog. Okay? So let's run the client again. Again, getting a new catalog. What I will do quickly before 1 minute time passes by, I will mark this catalog ID, copy the catalog ID. My first client is done. Now I will run my second client. And my second client, it will ask me for the catalog ID. So enter the catalog ID, which I copied it. I will paste my catalog ID here and click enter. So what happened now? The left branch is executed. So this branch actually gets executed now. This branch here, which is not the wait, which is the receive order. Let's see if this happened actually in AppFabric. So now if I go down to my instance, you will see it's completed, not terminated, but completed successfully. Okay? One more time, I can track the events and see what happened inside my business process. Okay, is that clear? Very good. Now let's talk about, I mean, that closes persistence. That's everything I have to show you about persistence. Yes?
I have a question. How was it managed after it was unloaded after 20 seconds?
After 20 seconds, it was unloaded, okay.
And how was it managed since it has been unloaded?
What do you mean by managed? Can you specify?
And how could you complete the process?
Actually, that's the engine. Because what I did in the second client, I copied the catalog ID, right? Mm-hmm. I give it to the second client. And I told my second client to continue from that moment. So, okay, this is very good. Let me show you here. My second client called this method, which is submit order. So it didn't call the first method. It called directly the second method. Now, because it was persistent, the App Fabric engine knew that this is a request for a persisted instance, actually unloaded instance, not persistent. This is a request for an unloaded instance. Go to the database and make this instance live again. And make it handle the request. Okay? Any questions? Yes?
Now you said there's unloading and persistence, and there's persistence only.
Yes.
So what is the case that, the technical case that we should use persistence only or persistence and unloading? Since you said persistence and unloading, it's better for memory management or memory resources.
Okay.
Is there a case that we should use persistence only and keep it in the memory?
Very good question. Actually, that's the case of the first demo. Why is that? In my first demo, I didn't unload, right? In the first demo, I only persisted. Why is that? Because I know, I will talk business. I know I'm dealing with a WCF bank service. And I know that this service can be down anytime. So it was always a good idea, just before go and invoking that service, to persist. So meaning, I'm telling my engine that, you know what, just in case anything bad happened inside my business process, I have this persistence point, you can always go back to that point. Okay? Is that a good answer for you? So, by the way, you have here also a shape called persistence. Called persist, sorry. So this is a shape called persist. Anytime you feel the need to persist your service, you believe that, you know, at some point something wrong might happen, you can just drag this shape, put it inside your business process, and it will create a persistence point for you. So that's the difference between persist and unload, business, in terms of business usage. Okay? Any more questions about persistence for closing the topic? Okay. Now, I mean, there's a topic that I want to talk about. It's not related to App Fabric, but it's always good. So every time I stand up, you have to stand up with me. Okay. Okay. So there's a topic called correlation. So what's correlation? Nobody asked me a simple question. Now, what happens if I submit a 20 catalog requests for my business process? Okay? Now I have 20 running WF instances, right? All of them persistent. Now, if the instance number 15 sent a response, how does the engine know that this request should be mapped to instance number 15, not to instance number 1 or 2 or 6 or whatever? How does that happen? Through something called correlation. Again, correlation is not related to App Fabric. Okay, but it's always very important to know. By correlation, correlation means that you take some unique ID in your business process and you say, this ID is my correlation item. So anytime I have multiple instances running at the same time, how do I know that this request belongs to that instance? Through the ID. So in my case, what is the ID?
Catalog.
Sorry?
Catalog.
Yes. Yes, catalog. Okay, you were saying, just make it louder. The catalog ID. That's why I copied the catalog ID. I did copy and paste it inside the second client. Because when I ran the second client, which again is trying to wake up an unloaded instance, how did the second client knew that my request is going to that instance? Now, in my case, I had only one instance running, but you get the point. So how did I do that? Through the catalog ID. So in my WF, here, I have something called correlates on. And there's an XPath, which is catalog ID. So this is an XPath inside my contract. Again, I told you that I'm not showing you the full code. I'm just giving you the idea. But inside the full code, there's a data contract. I mean, WSF developers know about something called contracts. So I have a data contract. Inside that data contract, there's something called ID. It's not related to our discussion, so just ignore it. So the important thing is that I'm telling the App Fabric engine, the WF engine actually, that correlate on the catalog ID. Okay, so whenever you get a request, map according to the catalog ID. Very good. Okay, so that's now persistence correlation, yes?
Okay, why is the instance ID not enough for correlation? Knowing which instance I have to map?
No, it can. But usually you correlate on business IDs. You don't correlate on instance IDs.
Okay, but correlation is not like needed in this example. It's like correlation is needed like in parallel process or something like this. Right?
No, it was needed here.
Why?
Because in the first request here, I requested a catalog.
Okay.
Right? And I got the response back. And I even closed the client. Remember, I closed the client completely.
Okay.
Now, there's a second client who needs to confirm that, you know, I like the catalog, book it for me. And it's coming on a completely different endpoint. It's coming into that endpoint.
Okay.
It's not like sequential.
Okay.
It's a flowchart. At any time, I can send a request. So that's why I needed correlation. Now, answer your question, why instance ID was not enough? Technically, it's enough. But think about this in business terms. When you're dealing with a client, you usually assign your client's IDs. So you have something called client IDs. And you usually want to correlate on this client ID. Because you know that your client has a certain ID. Each request he sends should be mapped to his instance. Okay? Good. Now, let me just check one thing. Okay, excuse me just for one moment. I want to set up the tracking. Now I will discuss tracking. So what is the tracking, do you remember? Anyone? Sorry? Yes, so monitoring is about monitoring events. The tracking is when you want to track certain